And so now let me introduce you the next speaker, Dr. Rossini. He's in specialization at Torino University in Italy. And his topic is about finite element analysis of upper first molar displacement during distalization with clear Invisalign aligners. Warm welcome.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. First of all, I want to thank the scientific committee for being here today. And I will present finite element analysis of upper molar distalization with aligners. Our aim was, first of all, to assess the force system configuration, which is applied on teeth during this type of movement. And to do so, we use the finite element analysis, which is adopted in mechanics and physics to solve mechanical problems and perform simulations. Upper molar distalization was demonstrated to be effective with Invisalign, with a mean distalization of 2.5 millimeters for upper molars. And for planning our study, we adopted the same technique as Gomez and collaborators for the building of the CAD model, and for the Young modulus and the Poisson ratio of the different materials. We also adopted information by this study from the Korean journal for the periodontal ligament, Young elastic modulus, and Poisson ratio. Okay. So we extracted STL data from a combine, we isolated teeth, and with the rhinoceros 3D, we built the attachments and put the CAD model in ANSYS, from which we built bone, periodontal ligament, attachment, and aligners. So we focus on three main questions. Is it worth to the sequentialization of movement? Is it worth to use elastics, and how? And if attachments are useful for this kind of treatment. So let's start from sequential movement. Here we can see a displacement of molars, upper molars, and canines together. The displacement prescribed was of 0.25 millimeters, as prescribed by Invisalign technique. And we can see that the anchorage loss is all on upper central and lateral incisors with and without attachments. Then we tried to move the upper first molar with the upper second molar in contact, so without first moving the upper second molar. And here we can see that this tooth experiences uncontrolled tipping, and more, the aligner bends in the center, so there's a loose of touch of the aligner on the crown of the tooth. Regarding attachments, we replicated the experiment by Gomez and collaborators. So we tested without attachment, and we obtained uncontrolled tipping. With rectangular attachment, vertical attachment, and there is more control, more intrusion, but also uncontrolled tipping. And with the optimized attachment, we can see that there is a distal bodily movement. But we repeated this experiment on the upper canine because of its position, which is different from the premolar one. So its natural inclination is different, and we can see that the uncontrolled tipping without attachment comes with a lot more intrusion. With rectangular attachment, there's a lot of more control, but also tipping, and with the optimized attachment, the tooth experiences pure intrusion. So this is a vector peak about upper canine displacement with the rectangular attachment, and we can see that the root of the canine, when distalized with this kind of attachment, experiences a buccal tipping. So it could be harmful for the periodontal of the patient. You should be careful if you adopt this kind of technique. So we proceeded with doing the simulation of the sequential distalization, starting from second molar displacement. We can see that with attachment, the anchorage is on the canine, which goes buccal, and without attachments, all the frontal group from canine to central incisor goes buccal. Also, the aligner gets of the upper first molar gets a deformation, and it has mesial rotation, but without great effects on the tooth. Then we proceeded with the upper first molar, and we can see that there is a rotation of canine and upper first molar with attachments, and without attachments, there is preinclination of upper incisors. Second premolar, it's almost the same. And first premolar has effects on incisors without attachments and on canines on attachments. At last, the canine, for the canine, the load is on upper incisors in both configurations, but with more movement and anchorage loss with attachments. So we proceeded with simulation of elastics. Elastics on two surfaces were simulated to simulate the application of these elastics on bonded buttons. And on aligners is a bonded button and on precision cut. So for upper canine displacement, we isolated this tooth, and only the attachment we already seen what happens. And with elastics on aligner, it experienced more intrusion with the loss of contact between the aligner and the tooth. And with the elastic on the tooth surface, it experienced a little bit of uncontrolled tipping, but with good control of the aligner staying on the tooth crown. So these are also vectorial images. The upper one is the upper canine simulation. This is the buccal view of attachment and class 2 elastics. Compared with no attachment, we can see as the class 2 elastics can greatly reduce the level of forces for intrusion, as well as compared to attachment only, the level of forces decrease a lot, so there is more control and lighter forces. This is the last simulation we performed that compares the use of attachments and class 2 elastics on with optimized attachment and without attachments when starting the distalization, so the second molar displacement. And as you can see, without attachment and using the elastics, there is a buccal movement of both the premolars and the canine roots. Instead, with attachment, there is great control and almost anything moves. There is a little palatal tipping of the canine root, but I don't know if you can see it from this view, but it's really non-significant. So the answer to our question, so if it is mandatory to sequentialize movement to adopt elastics and attachment, so in our opinion, it is. And as a take-home message we want to transmit is that the sequentialization of movements is the best way to perform this kind of treatment, that optimized attachments are mandatory to obtain bodily tooth movement, especially with the upper premolars. And then class 2 elastics, we simulated with 4 hunches, that for us is the best combination, and needs to be applied on upper canines directly on tooth surfaces 24 hours a day to increase the efficiency of movement and increase the efficiency of anchorage control. So last, I want to thank people that helped me, so Dr. Isidoro Mio, Mauro Calvone from .com that helped me with the analysis, Dr. Castro Florio and my colleagues which are here, and Dr. Parridi, which was necessary to do this research. Thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you, Dr. Rossini, for this excellent lecture.